I truly am thirsty for you, my God.
In my heart, I am thirsty for you, the living God.
Why am I discouraged? Why am I restless?
I trust you, and I will praise you again.
Because you help me, and you are my God.
Thank you.
sorry for our sins. Please join in the prayer of confession. Our God, you bless everyone whose sins you forgive.
You bless them by saying, you told me your sins.
Without trying to hide them, and now I forgive you.
We should always pray whenever we have sinned.
Then we won't be swept away by a raging flood.
You put songs in my heart because you have saved me.
Let us confess our sins in silence. Hear the good news. The Lord says, I will put my law in their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. Through Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. Amen.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. Decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back.
Please be seated. And now will the other people come to the
morning. First reading is from Isaiah chapter 58, verses 6 through 12. Is not this the kind of fasting I have chosen? To loose the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free and break every yoke? Is it not to share your food with the hungry and to provide the poor wanderer with shelter, when you see the naked to clothe them, and not to turn away from your own flesh and blood? Then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you, and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and he will say, "Here am I." If you do away with the yoke of oppression, with the pointing finger and malicious talk, and if you spend yourselves in behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then your light will rise in the darkness, and your night will become like the noonday. The Lord will guide you always. He will satisfy your needs in a sun-scorched land and strengthen your frame. You will be like a well-watered garden, like a spring whose waters never fail. Your people will rebuild the ancient ruins and will raise up the age-old foundations. You will be called the repairer of broken walls, restorer of streets with dwellings. Second reading is Romans chapter 15, verses 1 through 7. We who are strong ought to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Each of us should please our neighbors for their good, to build them up. For even Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, "The insults of those who insult you have fallen on me." For everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through the endurance taught in the scriptures and the encouragement they provide, we may have hope. May the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you the same attitude of mind towards each other that Christ Jesus has, so that with one mind and one voice, you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Accept one another, then, just as Christ accepted you, in order to praise God. Our gospel reading found in your bulletin is Matthew chapter 5, verses 7 through 16. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, then how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything, except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand and give its light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. This is the good news.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please join in singing together on the hymn.
Let us pray together on our knees.
Jesus never referred to his followers as Christians, and that seems strange, but that name came later for people who didn't like Jesus' followers. And they insulted them, and they called them little Christs, so Christian. And today we pretty much go by Christian. You know, we've settled for Christian, and it sounds good. But the thing is, you can define a Christian in almost any way, because it's not defined in the scriptures. It's only used three times in Acts of the Apostles and 1 Peter. So Jesus didn't call his followers Christians. He gave them a picture or a metaphor of who they were. And they took what Jesus said so seriously that today in the city of Rome, you see crosses everywhere. On the top of just about every building, you find there's crosses in the Colosseum, and you may think that, well, the Pope lives there, and maybe they have to do that, but if you go back to 64 AD, 30 years after Jesus, there was a big fire in Rome, and Nero thought he needed someone to blame it on, and he blamed it on the Christians. So he rounds the Christians up, he kills them, he throws them to the beasts, or crucifies them. And the Christians at that point could never imagine that there would be crosses in honor of Jesus all over their city, or that a day would come when no one would worship Jupiter or Zeus. And they couldn't imagine Christian churches or Christian cathedrals built for worship. But 300 years later, there were crosses everywhere in Rome. And it did not happen because Jesus' followers decided to be Christians. It happened because the followers of Jesus took seriously the picture or the description that he gave them. And over time, they changed the world. So why would we settle for Christian, which we can't even define, when Jesus gives us such clear instructions? And here's what he said in Matthew 5, which begins the Sermon on the Mount. So a crowd has gathered, and Jesus' disciples are up front, and Jesus says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, and blessed are those who mourn. Blessed are the meek and the gentle, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Blessed are the peacemakers." And his listeners are probably thinking, you know, this isn't something that I'm interested in. And then he said, "Blessed are those who are persecuted for my sake." And I'm sure the crowd didn't know what to think about that. So then Jesus gives them something in practical terms. He says, "You are the salt of the earth." And everybody then knew what salt was. It was what you added to food to keep it from going bad. And without salt, the food rots, and without salt, the food stinks. And back then, they didn't have refrigerators or chemicals with long names to make the food shelf safe. So salt was a lifesaver. Jesus is telling his followers, "You are the preservative of the entire earth. And if you don't preserve, the earth rots and the culture stinks. If you don't preserve, things go in a very negative direction." And it was a time when might made right. So the nation with the biggest army was who was right. And the people with the longest sword won. And there were not many rights for women or children or disabled persons. And back then, compassion and mercy and generosity were not virtues. So much of what we assume is common human decency is not common. It was learned. And so today we express a Jewish Christian ethic that goes deep into our culture. And how Americans are today is how we learn to be. As Jesus taught compassion and mercy and generosity, and it affects our culture and cultures everywhere. another person. And we know there's something wrong with that. And today we think generosity is a good thing. You know, maybe we don't always want to give, but at that time they thought if you were generous and you gave expecting nothing in return, well, that was a sign of weakness. So why do we say mercy is good and compassion is good? It's from a belief in one God who loves all people. And that belief exploded through the teachings of Jesus. And the first century Christians grabbed on to that picture that Jesus gave them. And so Jesus tells his followers, you may not have much power or money, and you may not have much standing, but you are the last stand. If you are not the salt of the earth rots. And we benefit every day from that worldview that men, women, and children have value, that they're made in the image of God, the God who loves everyone. So Jesus said, by this one thing, people will know you are my followers, by how you love one another, how you treat and how you care for one another. Jesus says, you are the light of the world, and a city placed up on a hill cannot be hidden. And so it was an area where things were very flat, and there were not trees, there were, you know, bushes. And so if you built a city on a hill and it was built with white limestone, you could see it for miles. A city on a hill, he said, cannot be hidden. So just as Jesus says, just as a city on a hill cannot be hidden, well, you be that way. You're like a strategically placed town. And now maybe you don't feel like you're in a position to be the light of the world, but Jesus says you are. And if you have a light, you put it on a stand, so it gives light to the whole house. In the same way, let your light shine. So people look at you, they see your good deeds, and they give glory to your Father in heaven. Jesus' message to his followers was, I want you to live your life in such a way that people see your good deeds, and they don't just go, oh, she's so nice, or he's such a nice guy. But, you know, he says, I want you to shine your light so people look at you and they go, are you kidding? Who is that generous? You know, who is that nice? What is up with them? They can't do enough for you. They help you over and over again. So Jesus says, I want your good deeds to be extraordinary, to make your light shine so bright that people give credit for your good deeds to your Father in heaven. So he says, his message for us is don't settle for Christians. Jesus didn't call anybody a Christian. He said, you are salt and you are light. And so those first century Christians, they got to work on that. And when pagan children were abandoned, they took them and raised them as their own. When plagues broke out and everybody left town, the Christians stayed and they took care of people they barely knew who were sick. And some lost their lives. They were salt and they were light. So they lived in a way that the society around them, the pagans, Roman, Greek people, took notice. And because of their powerful living, those followers took seriously their being salt and light. They made an impact. And Jesus would say to us, don't settle for anything less, to be salt and be light. And where people have given up hope and they think, well, nobody cares, then you go there and show up and you be salt and light. And some of you are Christian today because someone was salt and light to you, like Sunday school teachers or friends. And you feel like, well, God placed them in your life. God put them there just the right time, like a lamp placed on a stand. And my brother Pat passed away a month ago. God acts harder. And we lucked out because a lot of salt and life people helped us. There was Steve, who was a friend of Pat's neighbor, who took many loads of stuff we gave him to the church. And there was Mother Dorothy, who also took a lot of loads to the thrift store and was moral support, helped us clean, and let me stay in her house after we got rid of the bed. And there was another neighbor, Gloria, who went on a Facebook group in her town, and she found us someone who would come and take the lift chair, move it out of the house for free. And my brother Ed said, well, you know, he said, people always say to you, let me know if there's anything I can do for you. And he says, I tell them what they can do. and they did it, and it was great. And Ning Pio was one of those salt and life people who helped us. And she told us her husband is in the military, and every time they move to a different place, their base is located in the bad part of town, where there's so much need. And so she started offering to take a truck and pick up your furniture and household items to give to people that need them. So they showed up at Pat's apartment with some teenagers, and they took a bed and a dresser and lamps, and they asked about the microwave. And I wanted to keep it another couple days, but when Ning asked, you know, the right thing is to give. So she took the microwave, and they took spoons and forks and knives and toaster, a lot of things. They were a big help to us and to the family they were going to bring the items to. And besides picking up furniture and household items for people, Ning also has pizza and games for these families once a month at the gym at her church. And the parents she helps now even get their kids to behave by saying, I will call Miss Ning if you don't do your homework. And then the kids do their homework. So all these people helped us. They had souls and life. And I felt like God put them right there to help us. Like they were light on a lampstand that gave light to the whole house. And, you know, some of you are parents, and you're so grateful for people who influenced your children in a positive way. And doesn't it seem like God, you know, placed them right where they needed to be at the right time? Those are salt and light people. They do all sorts of things, and they don't think they're doing anything special. So my challenge for you this week is to ask, who is a person for whom you can be salt and light? Because you have no idea who is looking for hope, who might come to trust God because you are being salt and light. And let's not settle for Christian, but let's live out what Jesus called us to, being salt and light. And let's point the way forward with, oh my goodness, I can't believe it, type of good deeds. When you're salt and light, it has the potential to change everything, our families, our communities, our country, and the whole world. Amen. Please stand and join me in the testimony of the Apostles' Creed.
God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. powerful God and yet tender and loving to us, your children. We're so grateful for your Spirit that gives us the power to do your work and your will. And we pray by your grace and mercy that you help us to see what it is to be salt and light at work, at school, in our neighborhood. What does it look like to be a light to the world, to live in such a way that an empire is transformed? And we ask you to help us to be more effective salt and more effective light. We pray for peace in the world, in Ukraine, in the Middle East, in Haiti. We pray for those who suffered natural disasters. And we ask your healing and presence for those who are sick, especially Joanne Ulsh. And we pray for those who lost loved ones, especially the family of Roger Ulsh and of Reeves. We're grateful for all that you give to us, and we lift up to you now our thanks as well as our prayer requests, and we do so now in silence. Well, Holy God, we pray all this in confidence that you hear and answer. All glory, honor, and power to you, O Lord. Amen. And now please be seated. God, bless us. We now turn to blessing. service, that we might be salt and light to your world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now please join on the communion insert in the bulletin. God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to God Most High.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
Gracious God, we give you thanks for the gift of Jesus our Savior. In obedience to you, he suffered on the cross, was raised from the dead, and delivered us from sin and death. With your people of faith in all times, we praise you with joy.
Holy God, we come to your table to be fed the true bread of eternal life. With all the saints on heaven and earth, we glorify you. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, light of his glory and grace.
Please be seated. We remember on the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, blessed and broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup, and after giving thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." Let us pray the prayer our Savior taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, for all things are ready. The ushers may come forward.
Thank you. We give you thanks that you have refreshed us at your table by granting us the presence of Christ. Strengthen our faith, increase our love for one another, and send us forth into the world with courage and peace, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit.
Savior's done.